Did you guys still not like this arc?
I don't know what to think.
I thought it was pretty cliche.
Like, music was good.
Whatever. You guys are heartless.
Heartless woman. That's an AI. All right.
Don't worry about that. One thing is that they kind of went with it is like Vivy. This is like one of the first times that Vivy didn't like fight it. She basically just went with it. Like didn't try to save her.
I noticed that too. Yeah.
So I don't know if that really. I don't know if it's just like, you know, her kind of just trusting the system in a sense, or just like how she's just seeing how things are developing, even though she seemed like I don't want to say like regretting, but she definitely was like, it was recognizing like what she did, you know, towards the end, obviously.
you guys said it was cliche, so I guess you all called that last part when the guy shot himself, like, because it was pretty obvious.
Well, I actually thought, I thought Vivy was going to do something to save her. And then when she said, like, oh, and, like, you know, basically priority is, humans. So I thought, like, okay, maybe she's baiting Matsumoto. I don't know. I was, like, psyching. Yeah. I was, like, tricking my own, like, myself and my, with so many different things just of, like, what could happen. And then until, like, you know, she just straight up just, shot her fist right into the chest. I was like, all right, well, maybe this isn't going to happen.
I'll talk about that when he shot himself in the head. That's like...
I didn't mean that part being cliche. I think for me, the part that was cliche was that, you know, the person that was behind like the metal float was the original Grace. I kind of had already thought that from last week's episode because one of the last images was panning to, you know, the AI Grace in, you know, that like server area. So I was like, okay, obviously the Grace that we just met, probably not the real Grace. I felt like that was a bit cliche in that regard.
I just didn't really see the point of like this arc. Like, I don't really get where it fits all in with like the main storyline. So
the whole thing is they're basically just trying to, you know, was it slow AI down?
I get to David's point. Like, I don't really get the point of the arc from like from like the scientist's perspective. Like, yes, I get he had this emotional attachment with, you know, this nurse figure that helped him, you know, overcome his trauma at a young age, and then that kind of created that emotion between humans and AIs. I took it more as like a better progress of Vivy and the Toke, him finally being like helping her out because he's realizing, you know, what she's trying to achieve. The other part that I really didn't care for, I guess, in this week's episode was when Matsumoto, you know, makes a bunch of himself and transforms into like the hover bike, and the hover bike's like flying through. And I'm just like, all right, they probably sat there and just like, all right, guys, like, we got a fuck ton of budget. We got Wit Studio animating this. Like, how do we introduce some really badass scene? They're just like, all right, you know, we get Matsumoto to make a hover bike. Vivy flies through, like, you know, all this very like sleek animated stuff. And I was just like, I didn't really care for that scene at all. I was just get to the fucking core.
Felt like very, very style and like no substance. Like,
exactly.
No.
Legitimately, I thought that scene reminded me so much of Kingdom Hearts, like the gummy ship parts of Kingdom Hearts.
Exactly. Thank you.
I've always hated the gummy ship parts. Why are you bringing this into my show?
Wait, hold up. Let's do a little sidetrack here. Why do you hate the gummy ship part? The gummy ship part, it was probably one of the best things of Kingdom Hearts.
Oh my god, we cannot be friends. I'm with Taylor on this one.
No, especially Kingdom Hearts, Kingdom Hearts 2. In Kingdom Hearts 2, you could customize that shit way better. It actually felt like there's more of a point.
The gummy ship served as a purpose to give Chip and Dale a reason to stay in the series. Yes. Other than that, there was no purpose other than calling back to Chip and Dale.
It was kind of a waste.
There's a reason that they changed the gummy ship and dream drop distance. It wasn't obviously a better change, but they were just like, all right.
But they tried.
They tried.
Kingdom Hearts 2 did it right. I don't know why they changed it, but it was perfect in Kingdom Hearts 2.
Yeah.
Okay.
Shame.
Anyway.
back to the show.
We bought the box, though. I'm just saying. Yeah. We are about the box.
Kingdom Hearts did the gummy ships like right, but... this show did not.
No. Well, I mean, none of us are happy about that.
It was weird, too, because the sequence of it was kind of just... It just came out of, like, left field, right? Like, all of a sudden, this guy can make multiple versions of themselves and make this, like, floating ship thing. And apparently, they knew exactly where to go. And then at somewhat towards the end, when they flew up the tower, The scientists gave up and told him exactly where the core was, so I guess that was convenient. And then the music, they didn't even like extend it properly. They had to reloop the song that they were playing, and it was the exact same song.
Yeah.
So I was kind of hoping for like something else to play in the background, but it kind of is what it is. So yeah, it was definitely, I guess it was pretty, but yeah, I didn't really care much for it at the end. The only thing that it really that stood out to me was the fact that at the very end, yeah, right, the scientist shot himself.
Yeah, and then all of a sudden, the one hand in blue of the AI blood, and then the left hand now in red with the human blood. I felt like there's obviously some.
But that's happened to Vivy though. It's like, that's what I'm really curious about. So that got my attention. So now I'm more excited for the next arc because curious where they're going for that.
I'm kind of hoping they don't just skip time right away. Like, I actually want to see like Vivi's reaction after.
I think they're definitely going to skip
time. See, I think so too, but I don't want them to do it.
Well, just because you said that, Trent, now it's like I happen.
The one thing that I will give them credit to, you know, apart from the time skips, is I'm glad that they did actually correlate the scientists' kind of relation with Grace, where the reason why Grace became, you know, the host of the metal float is because she was a like ancestor sister of Vivy and what happened with the sunrise explosion. So I'm glad that, you know, everything is tying together from that standpoint, which I think is good. It's not like, you know, separate event, time skip all to like, you know, manipulate the relationship between AIs and stuff. So I do like that, but yeah, we'll have to see kind of. I agree with you guys where it's probably just going to be another time skip. And it's like, okay, you know, because of these events, this has had some impact on, you know, Vivy or the world and stuff. And then now we have this new event to take care of.
Do you guys think it's just a coincidence that they, like, all the sisters just keep dying?
No, I want to say Vivy, like the virus or whoever, or the one that orchestrated the AI's, like, uprising. It's either Vivy or just like her core program, I guess. That's what I'm guessing.
That's what I told Trent in this episode too. I was like, it's got to be that way.
Yeah.
Right. Because as of right now, it looks like they're going to be 4-for-4. So, and sneak peek for the next week's episode, you got another diva in a sense.
Yeah, that's going to be singer, focused. Right?
So this is what, the fourth generation of the model that Vivy is? Like,
I think like
her model type. So
one of us was saying in the beginning too, like this could be like a self-fulfilling prophecy where Matsumoto goes back in time, but then like all the things they do just end up causing the Vivy, the past, to become like the AI that starts like the robot war. So
yeah, that make a lot of sense, because you would think like Matsumoto would probably not ever think, and Vivy herself would not ever think, that Vivy is the one that, you know, caused all of this.
And from the looks of it, it's accelerating. Like, the fact that he went back in time, it's accelerating the process at which they do, like, become capable to uprise and take over. So, to be honest, I wouldn't blame her after what's been going on.
Yeah, I wonder if in that instance, then, I could see, like, if Vivi's not taking herself out, if Matsumoto will have some involvement. If Vivy is, you know, the true mastermind, and he has to be the one that takes her out.
Well, the thing is, though, Matsumoto is just following his orders, you know? So, in a sense, he's just following Vivi's orders. So then, if that were the case.
That's also true, right? Yeah, we don't know if Vivi's also controlling him in some grain. So,
it just seems like, like the way you describe it, Justin, it seems like he's just, if he becomes much more important, like, have a more important role in the story, which just doesn't feel that way so far. I just feel like he's just like a really, like, he's just a supportive character. It seems like Vivy just does everything, even with all the support from Matsumoto. It just seems like I just can't see him like taking that role, having to stop.
I agree. He definitely seems to take much more of a support character, especially in the last few episodes. Whereas when we first were introduced to him, we thought potentially, you know, he has more of a main focus. But I agree. I like the theory about Vivy being the mastermind of it all, especially with all of the sisters in the relation. So,
last thing I have to say is RIP. Bot number 205.
He was a good bot.
He was.
Rip all the Nier Automata robots.
Yep.
Yeah.
See, I think that's why I'm enjoying this show a little bit more than you guys. Sorry, I'll just say that really quick. Is that I feel like I'm focusing a little bit more on like the human drama of each arc, or in this case, not necessarily human, but just like the character drama of each episode or each arc, rather than like getting stuck in the nuances of the plot. I'm kind of just like letting that ride. I'm not looking at it too closely, and I'll I'll just see where it goes. I don't have strong opinions about how they're doing it one way or the other. I just focused more on the drama. So that made me sad. That's why I liked it, because I wasn't trying to predict what would happen to them. So I just felt sad. I felt so sad for all the near robots at the end.
It was all touching moments, especially number 205, where they basically were just saying, we're programmed that, you know, humans like surprises.
And I felt bad for the scientist. Like, you know, he just had kind of a shit time his whole life. Like, I felt bad for them all.
Yeah.
He's like kind of a creep, not gonna lie.
Jesus, so? I wouldn't go that far.
I know, right? Damn.
He's a creep.
He's kind of a creep.
Why? Koo, if you could have like a hot AI girlfriend that you could marry, you're saying you wouldn't. I don't believe you for a second.
me and Taylor have already had this conversation.
Yeah, we have. If AI ever becomes real, we'll separate.
We both said yes.
At the end of the day, guys and girls, it's not real, okay? It's all machinery.
Just keep saying that, Koo. Just until she gets taken away and has to, you know, run on a whole island.
You know what? We'll cross that bridge when we get to it.
Fair enough. Koo, okay. If this happens, I better be your best man.
Look, you guys already know. I don't even know why you guys are questioning it. But I want to call this guy a creep because he kind of is a creep.
Oh.
I do get that it kind of sucks that his mom whatever left him in a hospital and then this guy like has grace to like comfort the guy. But then, you know, like he grew up, became a scientist, came back, and he's been thinking of her like nonstop. That's a little bit creepy, even if it's an AI. Like imagine if it was like a regular human being, right? Like I still find it kind of creepy.
I find it more creepy. Like, I don't say creepy just because like there's so much like sci-fi movies about like people falling in love with AI, so I don't. It's just that.
Well, I think like, who is talking about like the age thing though, like him like meeting her as like a kid and then marrying her as an adult. Is that the part that creeps you out, or is it more the fact that she's an AI, or is it a combo of the two?
It's a little bit of everything, and it's just the mindset that you have to have to like follow through with it as well. I find it to be a little creepy.
No, that's a good point, because now that I do think about it, think if they did get married and then, you know, he continues out his life and he's like an old like grandpa looking dude, and here he is with his non-aging AI wife. It's just like,
This is a concept that I have been like exposed to since I was a small child with younger females, older male vampires. Like that's the thing that's been around for a long time. So to me, it doesn't even faze me.
It's funny because it's like the constant defense of like when people have like attractions to certain female characters and they're in like a younger state, but they're like, oh no, it's fine, like they're a 500 year old, you know, demon lord. We let it slide.
They see Monogatari.
Anyways. but again boys and girls, it's not real, it's all fake, so
it's not real yet.
Okay,
yes you keep telling yourself that,
looking
Brian.
Forward to seeing where Vivy and her adventure takes.
Yeah, I'm excited for the next arc. So
I still love it. I don't know. I still love the show. Yeah. I still love the show.
Yeah. So we'll see what happens.